seems like 90-something% of all you hear is that this is the greatest time for the body of Christ. Well, they're wrong. It's not. It's not the greatest time. This is the worst time. It's the worst. You should be uncomfortable at what is going on. You should be uncomfortable at the sin in the land. You ought to be uncomfortable at what's happening. You ought to be uncomfortable at the way the devil is infusing himself into the body of Christ, and the body of Christ is mixing the perverse with the sacred. You ought to be uncomfortable. This is not a comfortable time for a believer.
Independent. When you think about the long history of America, Barack Obama makes us proud. All Americans. All Americans.
And now you see the church with preachers and ministers and people just disregarding abortion, disregarding same-sex marriage, just disregarding the issues that are most important to Jehovah God, most important concern the scriptures. They just disregard that for, a racial reason to vote for a black man, or for historical reason that blacks are always Democrats.
If they make a mistake, I don't want them punished with a baby. There will always be people, many of goodwill, who do not share my view on the issue of choice. On this fundamental issue, I will not yield, and Planned Parenthood will not yield.
The man is an abomination. He is someone who has actually advocated infanticide, that when babies are the target of abortion, if they happen to escape the abortionist's intention and are born alive, he actually supported the idea that those babies should be set aside to die. That is a man with such a seared conscience, I can't even understand why anybody in their right mind would consider him worthy of political support. That's a violation of conscience that is inconceivable. And even some of the most hardline pro-abortion people in America rejected that abomination, and he did not.
We want to make sure that people understand my agenda, what I will do as president. I am confident that if the American people know what my plan for America is and what John McCain's plan for America is, that I will win this race.
I never thought I would say what I'm going to say to you. I said it privately. What I say in private, I can say publicly. And it's not what you say, it's how you say it. I give all due respect to our brother Barack Obama, but he is sincerely wrong in a lot of things that he has said pertaining to the Church of Jesus Christ. And he comes out of a church that is very liberal, so that tells me he's a liberal man. But the spirit of the Antichrist is what is on him. And you know, all during the primary, I stood with him, meaning I believed. And, you know, you and I had difference of opinions about that, but we still respect each other.
Yes, sir.
But at the same time, I must be honest and say to you that what I saw, the Spirit of God, the Spirit that I saw this man, is troubling.
When I say, everyone that has listened to this, you go do your own research, go, you know, find out what's going on, what these men stand for, and check their record, check what they've said, what they've done in the past, what they, you know, are claiming, before you make a decision to invite this brother into your church or go see him at somebody else's church.
His unyielding belief in the simple idea that closing the gap between the world as it is and the world as it should be is precisely why he will be a president that will make us all proud. Because Barack is not new to the cause of the LGBT community. It has been a conviction of his career since he was first elected to public office. Your voices of truth and hope and of possibility have got to drown out the skeptics and the cynics. And if you stand with my husband, if you reach for what is possible, and if you refuse to let this chance get away, that's why he went to Ebenezer Baptist Church and he said that we need to get over homophobia in the African American community. That if we're honest with ourselves, we'll embrace our gay brothers and sisters instead of scorning them.
And yet, if we are honest with ourselves, we must admit that none of our hands are entirely clean. If we're honest with ourselves, we'll acknowledge that our own community has not always been true to King's vision of a beloved community. If we're honest with ourselves, we have to admit that there have been times when we've scorned our gay brothers and sisters instead of embracing them.
A little leaven affects the entire loaf and changes its appearance, texture, and consistency. This is what politics from the pulpit always does. It changes preachers, churches, and members. Galatians 5 says a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. So when we preach politics and influence our congregations to vote a certain way, to seek a certain man and put a certain man in office, then we have compromised our people.
I mean, you're just going to vote because a man is black, but you, I mean, what has this man done for black people, period? You know, nothing. And then he's got this gay agenda in his holster and can't wait to pull it out and begin firing, and this is going to affect all of our children. It's going to affect our churches. It's going to affect the way I preach. It's already affected the way a lot of people preach.
He's going to be the best president we've ever known.
We know that what began as a whisper has now swelled to a chorus that cannot be ignored, that will not be deterred, that will ring out across this land as a hymn that will heal this nation, repair this world, make this time different than all the rest. Yes, we can. Let's go work. Moment in history, you can give this country the change that we need. You can do this right here in North Carolina. We will win this general election, you and I together. We're going to change this country. We're going to change the world. Thank you, everybody.
As the election of our American president is drawing closer, we're beginning to just see, I mean, I consider the plan of the Antichrist, the end time, as well as the plan of God or the prophecy of God being fulfilled right before our eyes.
Because of victories in California, Washington, Oregon, and Hawaii, CBS projects that Senator Barack Obama of Illinois will be the next president of the United States.
This is almost beast, mark of the beast rehearsal, this actual election. It's like people are rehearsing to select the mark of the beast because they won't be able to buy or sell.
Right.
That means they will give up their conviction. That means they will give up their morality. They'll
right.
give up their stand for Christ. But not only
right.
that, they don't know the politics either.
Exactly.
So all they know is what the media show them. All they know is what's on the surface. Or all they know is what they think is going to happen to their financial state.
Peggy Joseph took her daughter out of school early Wednesday for this. Her emotions ran high following Obama's speech.
It was the most memorable time of my life. It was a touching moment. Because I never thought this day would ever happen. I won't have to worry about putting gas in my car. I won't have to worry about paying my mortgage. You know, if I help him, he's going to help me.
I'm Dana Hughes in Kugelo, Kenya, the small village that Barack Obama's father hails from and where his step-grandmother and many of his extended family still live. On the family homestead today has been one long party. The president of Kenya has declared tomorrow a national holiday.
There's a fascination that a man whose father was Muslim can become president of the United States. And there is great hope that Obama can change deeply controversial policies and focus as much on economic development as on the war on terror.
Nowhere was Barack Obama's support greater than in Europe before the election, and nowhere has the enthusiasm been greater at his victory. They're describing him in glowing terms. One newspaper here in the UK saying, a new world dawns.
Be Barack Obama.
Barack Obama spent 4 years of his childhood in Jakarta. So when his classmates, teachers, friends, and relatives got the news of his victory, it was a proud moment.
I'm speechless. I'm very grateful. Thank God for him that finally he achieved what he's been seeking all this time. Good luck, Barry.
Everything about his administration is geared toward homosexuality and lesbianism. He's done things that are unspeakable that no other president ever would have wanted on their record. Right now, this is what we're up against. We're up against it for our kids, our school, anybody in here with children. You need to be very, very concerned about number 44. Obama's administration has been working hard to lower the age of sexual consent from 17 to 13. 13 years old. The Antichrist agenda of the LGBT, which is lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender, is no longer subtle, but it is now right in our faces. How many of you know that? No longer are homosexuals the victims, but now they are leading the charge because of their presence in our society. They have taken control of major areas of influence and are now making their move to take over the world.
We are moving ahead on Don't Ask, Don't Tell. We should not be punishing patriotic Americans who have stepped forward to serve this country. We should be celebrating their willingness to show such courage and selflessness on behalf of their fellow citizens, especially when we're fighting two wars.
Barack Obama got in, he wrote an executive proclamation, signed it, and signed June into the official LGBT celebration month in our nation. You turn on the radio now, who's talking about this? I've yet to hear a black preacher preach about this month. No black preacher I've seen has said anything about June because they can't. they put their foot in their mouth because they told all their folks to go vote for Obama.
Days after President Obama announces his support for same-sex marriage, pastors and priests from across Maryland take to their own pulpits with their reaction and, in some cases, condemnation of the president. WJZ is live tonight. Derek Valcourt explains the president's comments have folks on both sides of this issue pretty fired up.
When President Obama announced that his position on same-sex marriage had evolved,
I think same-sex couples should be able to get married.
It outraged some African-American pastors like Delegate Emmett Burns.
He has said to his base, African-Americans, I'm going against your beliefs and your thoughts.
He's so opposed to same-sex marriage, he told church members he will no longer support the president and now predicts Obama will lose the election.
Many African-American religious leaders say they will continue to support the president even if they do not agree with him on this one issue. Derek Valcourt, WJZ Eyewitness News.
All right, Derek, thanks so much. And polls show 50% of Americans say they favor same-sex marriage. And the most recent poll shows that the support is also coming from a majority of Democrats, independents, non-religious voters, and Catholics.
Obviously, you are a supporter. Am I correct? You're a supporter of President Obama, Reverend Coates,
right?
Very
much so.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So you disagree with the civil rights aspect of Reverend Burns. You feel that this is the same as blacks struggling to get. The same?
There's no doubt about it.
I,
with all due respect to Reverend Burns, I believe that it's critically important to understand that there's no group that has a monopoly on civil rights. As a Christian evangelical pastor and as an American, I support equal treatment under the law for all citizens of this country, even those who are gay and lesbians. You know, freedom of choice,
so you,
bill and
yeah,
freedom
I know
of
that, but you support free in every way, right? You don't want to make
anything. Absolutely.
Now, what if then I were of a persuasion, a religious persuasion, that said polygamy was okay, and you know they're out there. You know they are out there. So Reverend Coates, support me to marry three or four women, or
Well,
you got to answer this because it
listen,
ties
Bill.
Back in with the redefinition of marriage. So would you
listen,
support
Bill.
Me marrying plural people?
Listen, Bill, this is an issue that's not on the table. The reality I have members of my family and of my church family who are right now doing multiple tours of duty in Afghanistan and Iraq. And I think it's highly ironic that we have sending our sons and daughters to defend freedom abroad, and yet we are denying freedom to people here in our country.
But I'm just asking you, for another minority, the polygamists, do they get the same consideration?
I have not heard President Obama express a view on that.
No,
I don't believe that is an issue.
Never
that's
will. It's
that's
just,
not
I,
an issue
I,
that's
I mean,
on the
I,
table.
You've got to think about it. All right.
You see, a lot of the black leaders that have now begun to back Barack Obama in spite of their indifference I call it the Antichrist agenda, which is homosexuality, abortion, and the silencing of the church, or the amendment to keep, or the bill to keep the church from preaching against the sin.
See, this morning there's going to be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth in some of these churches, because those men who should have been seeking the face of God was seeking a black face, and they lifted this man up over their people. Now they look crazy. Now you've shown you have no discernment. Now you've shown you have no prophecy. Now you've shown that you can't see. And you led your people astray. So what the church folks, what you shocked about? Yeah, we were talking about him, and all the churches, you know, during that time shut me out and wouldn't bring me to town. Because we had the information. Because they didn't want me messing up the election. Man, won't it? There's going to be some big, big time breakfasts in churches this morning, because there's a whole lot of egg on folks' faces.
Leaders right now are really dazed by this, because we didn't see it coming. For the last 4 years, the African-American clergy have really supported, covered, and prayed for President Obama, and it really came without any warning. It came without any warning.
It came without any warning.
Yeah, that's what the announcement was for. Obama was letting you know, this is what it is. This is the way it is. This is the way I've always been. All you have to do is trot to exministries.com, and you would have heard him say for himself that he's waiting on the day to come when marriage between a man and a man, a woman and a woman, would be just as admirable as marriage between a man and a woman. That's on been on our website since he started running.
You will see a time in which we as a nation finally recognize relationships between two men or two women as just as real and admirable as relationships between a man and a woman.
Senator Obama, you say you're a Christian, but Ambassador Keith said that your record runs counter to Jesus' teachings. What's your reaction to your opponent's assertion that your own Lord and Savior wouldn't even vote for you?
Well, you know, my first reaction was I actually wanted to find out who Mr. Keyes' pollster was, because if I had the opportunity to talk to Jesus Christ, I'd be asking something much more important than the Senate race. I'd want to know whether I was going up or down. There are all sorts of questions I think that I'd be interested in. Look, I'm very proud of my Christianity, and it sustains me, and it's part of what motivates me to get involved in public service. As I said before, I started in this town, in Chicago, organizing with churches. And the enormous faith and resilience and courage that was shown by persons of faith made all the difference in the world in terms of setting up after-school programs for youth or making sure that we have affordable housing in many communities that are having tough times all across this state. But what I don't think is appropriate as a public servant is for me to assume my faith is absolute and to therefore presume that people who are of different faiths and have different perspectives are somehow evil or wrong or that I can't have a dialogue with them and arrive at common ground.
Thank you very much, Mr. Keyes.
But of course, the question involved here wasn't people of different faiths, but people who profess the same faith. And that faith is faith in Jesus Christ. And the question I think that I would pose to the Lord is not whether I'm going up or going down. I want to know where he stands so that I may follow him. I want to know where he stands with respect to the will of the Father to whom he looks. And on these questions like abortion, he says the taking of innocent life is an abomination. On these questions like traditional marriage, he says he created us male and female, and that the wrong use of the body in this way is, again, as the scripture says, an abomination. He defined marriage not as the union of man and man or woman and woman, but as man and woman, and the two become one flesh, something that is possible only in the course of procreation. So when I look at where Christ stands and I look at where Senator Obama stands, based upon that record of Christ's understanding, which we acknowledge as Christians to be the true record, I say, well, Christ is over here, Senator Obama's over there, the two don't look the same. And that means that I'm not thinking about Alan Keyes. I am thinking about the Lord. And to say I don't have the right to do that means that you're trying to suggest that my faith-shaped conscience has no place in our politics. And yet if I go into the voting booth or into public life without my faith-shaped conscience, then I have no conscience. For the Lord said I must love him with my whole heart, soul, mind, and strength. There's nothing left over. Without faith, there is just a faith-shaped void where the conscience ought to be. And I challenge all the voters of this state who profess to believe in Christ. How can you vote from such a faith-shaped void? Without the Lord, your vote will not be based upon that faith which ought to shape your life. And for anyone to suggest that you leave it behind at
Thank
the
you,
door
sir.
Of the voting booth or public service suggests something utterly incompatible.
Hey, Nicole, evangelist Franklin Graham suggested that he's uncertain about the president's Christianity on a cable news program. Franklin Graham appeared to question President Obama's faith when he appeared on MSNBC's Morning Joe in New York yesterday. He was asked whether Graham believes President Obama is a Christian, and his response, which you're about to hear, has been a hot topic. The White House appears to be brushing it off, but when Press Secretary Jay Carney was asked about Graham's comments, he said President Obama didn't talk at all about it.
You have to ask every person, but he has said he's a Christian, so I just have to assume, you know, that he is. President Obama, the Muslims of the world, he seems to be more concerned about them than the Christians that are being murdered in the Muslim countries. That's what bothers me.
And I consider it part of my responsibility as President of the United States to fight against negative stereotypes of Islam wherever they appear.
Reverend Franklin Graham has made some comments on several occasions, as recently as 3 weeks ago, really questioning the faith, if you will, of the president. He said the president has told him that he's a Christian, but he basically said that going to church does not make you a Christian. But the president is on record as saying that he walked down that aisle, he gave his life to Christ. So what do you say to folks like Reverend Graham, who frankly are muddying the water, but other people who are questioning the Christianity of this president?
I find it insulting. We didn't question the Christianity of President Bush when he said he accepted Christ. And I'm disappointed in Reverend Franklin Graham in that regard. I wish he had the diplomacy of his father, who brought the gospel to people without being nuanced by politics. Because when you do those things, you offend people that you're actually called to save and to serve. And I would hope that he would see the rationale in apologizing for such statements, because if the president's faith is suspect, then all of our faith are suspect, because the Bible is quite clear about what it takes to be saved, and the president has been quite open about his accepting Christ and him openly confessing it before men. And if it's good enough for the Bible, it ought to be good enough for the rest of us.
I certainly agree with you on that.
People just all excited because Obama said he was a Christian, and then they get in office and cancel the day of prayer and then bring the Muslims in to pray. Well, he didn't mean it like that, see, because he's president. He got to like everybody. He has to be for everyone. Well, how is he a Christian if he's for every religion? Is that what Christians are?
Well, a Newsweek poll shows that 12% of America believes that you're a Muslim, and 26% believe you were raised in a Muslim home. A lot of misinformation. How do you fight that?
Well, you know, by getting on Larry King and telling everybody I'm a Christian and I wasn't raised in a Muslim home.
Assalamu alaikum. Many other Americans have Muslims in their families or have lived in a Muslim-majority country. I know, because I am one of them. But my father came from a Kenyan family that includes generations of Muslims. As a boy, I spent several years in Indonesia and heard the call of the azan at the break of dawn. I have known Islam on three continents before coming to the region where it was first revealed. That experience guides my conviction.
You're absolutely right that John McCain has not talked about my Muslim faith.
All the things that have been reported in these emails are completely untrue and have been debunked again and again and again. So hey, all you can do is just tell the truth and trust in the American people that over time they're going to know what the truth is.